Well, good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us here at the state capitol to sign into law another important achievement of this legislative session, with yet more to come. I'd like to start off by recognizing the leaders from in and outside of government standing with me today who made this moment possible, starting with Representative Janet Yang Rohr, who championed this legislation in the House, as well as State Senate sponsor President Don Harmon, both of whom led this science-backed, family-first, common-sense solution our students, families, and school districts deserve. And representing teachers across more than 800 districts that serve Illinois children in districts both rural, suburban, and urban alike, Dan Montgomery, President and COO of the Illinois Federation of Teachers, IFT Executive Vice President Stacy Davis Gates, and Illinois Education Association Government Relations Director Sean Denny. Kathy Griffin, president of the IEA, could not make it to Springfield this morning, but I want to recognize her as an indispensable part of bringing all the interests to the table and getting this done. In January, these leaders here and others from across the state joined together with a promise that we would take important steps to protect our students and their parents. Our teachers, our bus drivers, our classroom support staff, our food service providers, and all the workers who make our school districts strong, including members of the communities our schools reside in. We want to ensure that our school children would see the fewest disruptions to their in-person learning due to the public health crisis. The bill I'll sign into law today fulfills that promise. It ensures that if a teacher has done their part to keep their classroom safe for their most vulnerable students, they won't have to worry for a second about their pay or their paid time off if they get COVID, or if they're required to isolate, or if the school has moved to e-learning and their work can't be done at home. Most importantly, this legislation recognizes that our teachers are so much more than their profession. They are members of our communities, and in many cases, they are parents. That means that on top of all that they've shouldered over these past 2 years, working in person when others did not, shepherding their students through trauma and turmoil, innovating new teaching methods online on the fly, they were dealing with all the same worries and what ifs of any parent. What do I do if my kid gets sick or has to isolate? Will I be able to stay home to care for them, to feed them, to make sure they're safe and not alone? Perhaps more than any other profession, educators have borne this burden. So we're extending employee paid leave to cover their children's needs too, ensuring that if an employee's child gets sick or has to isolate and quarantine, they have one less thing to worry about. Critically, this bill retroactively returns COVID-related sick leave to all vaccinated teachers for the last school year too. We're not only taking actions that recognize the important work that teachers and school support staff do, we're also sending a message to future educators that this is a profession in Illinois that you should choose, that cares about you, and that will protect you, your students, and your communities when hard times hit us. At a time when we want to bring people into the education professions, this bill will help Illinois retain and attract teachers and support staff. We have two incredible educators here with us today. Robert Lujai, a social studies teacher at Naperville Central High, and Angela Bulger, who works at Central Elementary in O'Fallon. We'll all have the privilege of hearing what this legislation means to them in their own words in just a few moments. But I want to say, Angela, Robert, on behalf of a grateful state, thank you for all that you do for the young people who walk into your classrooms each day. Day after day, class after class, year after year, our kids have the chance to dream bigger because of you. It's my hope that this new law takes just a bit of weight off your shoulders. Another way that we can show the true depth of appreciation for all that you and your fellow educators do. So thank you, and with that, I'd like to turn things over to the bill's sponsor in the House and a steadfast advocate for teachers, Representative Janet Yang Rohr. Janet?
Thank you, Governor Pritzker. Thank you, everyone, for being here today. I am Janet Yang Rohr. I am the state representative for the 41st District representing the Naperville area. On behalf of my district, on behalf of Naperville, on behalf of so many people in this room, it is just an incredible honor and privilege to be here today for this bill signing, to pass this legislation all the way through. It's an honor to be here with these incredible educators, Robert Lujai, Angela. You know, just a few months ago, I was with Robert. I was with the Naperville 203 teachers, Indian Prairie 204 teachers and educators, paraprofessionals, support staff. I was with Wheaton-Wardenville 200 educators. We were there together meeting because they were telling me about how COVID was affecting them. They were telling me about these really truly awful stories, how they were already burning through so many of their sick days. It was just already a few months into the school year, but we already had, especially our new educators, who were worried that they had to already be taking unpaid sick leave. This is not a situation that we should have had them in. These are the people that we want to retain, that we want to attract into the profession. This legislation is going to do what good legislation should do, what we should all strive to do as legislators, as your representatives, and that's to solve real problems and problems for the people that we entrust to bring our students forward. And so for the last 2 years, we have absolutely lauded the Herculean efforts that our educators, our support staff, our administrators, our bus drivers have had to do to keep our schools running, to keep our students learning, all while keeping them safe and healthy at the same time. This legislation, HB 1167, the COVID Wage and Benefits Protection Bill, what it does, it really allows us to put action behind our words. Robert and Angela, I want to thank you and your colleagues for trusting us, for trusting your representatives, your senators, your governor, to take this legislation forward to be able to support you. Even as your colleagues, you and your colleagues have had to move our students forward and have been so successful at doing so, we have had the privilege of supporting you, and I thank you for that. With that, I'd like to introduce the Senate sponsor to this bill, Senate President Don Harmon.
Thank you, Representative, and thank you, Governor Pritzker. A lot of people were involved in putting this proposal together and negotiating a workable agreement that could get us to this day. I'd like to thank the members and the leaders of the Illinois Education Association, the Chicago Teachers Union, and the Illinois Federation of Teachers, whose president I'll introduce in a moment. But I want to thank them for their efforts and their commitment to the professional educators who lead classrooms across this great state. And of course, Governor, I'd like to thank the Illinois Department of Public Health, the Illinois Emergency Management Agency, and the Illinois National Guard, as well as the nurses and doctors of the tremendous medical community we have in Illinois, for all they've done to make vaccines available to anyone and everyone in Illinois. This new law is about supporting our teachers and education community. This is a step to recognize those who have done all they can to protect themselves, their families, their students, and their schools, but still end up facing hardship because of the pandemic. They've played by the rules, done everything that was recommended, and they shouldn't lose sick days or pay for doing the right thing. I want to thank the governor for his efforts to bring people together to find a common sense approach to address this situation. This shows we can accomplish working together, and I expect we'll have a lot more accomplishments in the days ahead. And so with that, I would turn it over to a true champion for teachers, and even more importantly, a true champion for students, the president of the IFT, Dan Montgomery.
Thank you, President Harmon. Good morning, everybody. I'm Dan Montgomery. I'm
High school English teacher from Skokie and the president of the Illinois Federation of Teachers, and it's a real honor and privilege to be here today with you and with the governor as he signs this very important bill. I want to thank Representative Yang Rohr for her dogged work in getting this started and being the lead sponsor in the House, and certainly Senator Harmon, President Harmon, for being extremely helpful in shepherding this through, and Deputy Governor Martin Torres for Education, who was also very helpful. There's a lot of people who had a hand in making this happen. In March of 2020, you know, teachers and paraprofessionals and folks in higher ed all over the state had to, on a dime, turn around and figure out how we educate and care for children remotely and in the midst of the worst pandemic in anyone's lifetime. We did that, and it's very difficult. And obviously, our own members and teachers and staff faced the sicknesses in their own families, and even, sadly, death, obviously, among students. So our North Star has been, how do we keep people safe? How do we keep schools open and in person safely? And how do we care for the children and their families in our charge? And Angela, who I'll introduce in a moment, who's a paraprofessional in O'Fallon, can speak to you about the personal effects of this bill better than I. But I can say this, you know, I think we are grateful to work in a state which has leadership like Governor Pritzker and the other legislators here who have made keeping people safe and healthy, vaccinating our communities, especially attending to the disparate impact of in black and brown communities. We see that in schools every day. And every day we see more dramatic data and information about the profoundly destructive impacts of COVID for our students of color and for poor people. And this legislation, like other things that have happened in Springfield, is part of that, is part of addressing that and making sure we can have all the staff, the teachers and support staff in schools we need as much as we can and do it safely. And I really appreciate, Governor Pritzker, that you mentioned the teacher shortage and trying to make conditions for teachers. We need to get people to want to come into this profession, to want to go every day into a class of 20 or 30 kids and say good morning and help build those lives in our future. And right now we don't have enough. And this is part of that too. So it's dramatically important. And the last thing I'll say is, and President Harmon alluded to this, you know, work in legislation is difficult. People don't always agree. You know, there are struggles and differences of opinion, and we've seen around the country and certainly around the state that those tensions are inflamed during COVID. But this bill is a sign that when you have good public servants of goodwill who devote themselves to trying to figure out what's the right thing to do, we can all work together and get it done and do it in a way that is better for learning, teaching, and the kids and their communities of the state. So I'm very grateful to Governor Pritzker and his leadership in this. Thank you, and let me introduce Angela Bulger, who's a paraprofessional, a teacher's aide in special ed, lower grade special ed classes in O'Fallon in the Central Elementary School. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Montgomery. Good morning, my name is Angela Bulger. I'm a paraprofessional from Central Elementary School at Central School District 104 in O'Fallon, Illinois. I am also a member of the Illinois Federation of Teachers. I started working at Central District 104 in August of 2021, where I love my job and I love working with the students. Since I started my position, I had to miss 8 days for COVID-related reasons. For example, I contracted COVID in January of this year. And when my 7-year-old daughter, who was exposed to COVID at school, I had to miss work to be home with her. As a new employee, I am allotted 11 sick days. Without this legislation, any additional days missed because of COVID would also mean a cut in pay because I have no more earned sick days. I am thankful to my union and for the governor for working on this legislation. Because of this new law, when I have to miss school to keep students safe and prevent the spread of COVID, I don't also have to worry about how I will pay my bills or if I need to think about finding a different job. Again, I would like to thank the governor, the union, and all supporters of this bill. And now I'd like to turn it over to Robert Lugai.
Good morning. My name is Rob Lujai, and I'm a social studies teacher out of Naperville Central High School. My coworkers and I are thankful we were able to be a part of this process and appreciate the fact that 1167 is being signed into law today. Providing COVID administrative days and pay tech protection for hourly employees who have worked diligently to provide a quality education for their students while also keeping them, their schools, and their communities safe for the past 2 years is a sign of true respect for educators. I'll personally benefit from this law. When I was sick last year and symptomatic, I went to Walgreens and bought the testing kit. My kit turned in negative, but since I was showing symptoms, I alerted my employer. The school district policy at the time required that I test negative on a PCR test before I returned to school. I got the PCR test and then waited 3 days to get the results. Those were sick days I used because my employer required the second test. Because Governor Pritzker is signing this bill today, I will have those sick days returned to me. I have colleagues who are out for 10 days, 20 days or longer due to an exposure, multiple exposures, and or testing positive for COVID-19. We have some support staff and teachers who have exhausted their sick days and personal time because of the COVID-19 pandemic. For example, my husband, a first year social worker, had COVID-19 and burned through all of his sick time this year. Restoring these days and this lost pay allows educators and employees some relief through what has been the most stressful time of our careers. In addition, we know there is a shortage of education employees across the state of Illinois. This bill will help to attract and retain those who have given so much over the past 2 years and those who are willing to make their life's work for the students of Illinois. And with that, Governor Pritzker, I think it's time to...
side one the other, and I'll stand away. Maybe you want to stand with them, Janet. Great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. We don't want to lose that.
Oh my God.
Great. Happy to take any questions from members of the media. Mark. We worked hard to lower the cost of healthcare and to expand healthcare to more people. And I think you know that when I came into office, there were tens of thousands, indeed over 100,000 people whose Medicaid applications were just sitting there managed by HFS, and we brought a new team in between HFS and DHS. We've been able to work through all of that backlog and expand healthcare to many more people at a lower cost. So we've already made an enormous dent. There's of course more to do. Not given up on it. We've been watching other states that have implemented the public option to see how they've worked out the challenges that have come with it, and we continue to observe that.
Governor, do you say the state police airport has seven seats?
The state police airport has seven seats,
three
of which are vacant. Mm-hmm. What's being done about that on your end? And also, just like with the prisoner review board issue, are you concerned that Republicans are going to use the merit board issue with the vacancies to change you as we kind of policy?
Well, these positions, like those others you mentioned, shouldn't be politicized. And of course, we're always looking at good options for appointing people to the merit board as we do to the other boards.
Sorry.
Well, you know, I've been a Democrat my whole life, and I've supported not just the DGA, but the DCCC, the DNC, and Democrats up and down the ticket, both here in Illinois and across the nation. So, you know, I think it's important that Democrats be involved in telling the truth out there. And when it comes to what the DGA is doing here in Illinois, they're simply telling the truth, which is more than the Irvin campaign could say. And so they're getting the word out about what the truth is about his record. Well, what we're trying to do, of course, is to encourage people to do the right thing, to keep their students safe, to keep the rest of the school safe by being vaccinated. That's the whole purpose of that provision in the law.
Mike. This is obviously an earlier version of this proposal, and it went to the governor's desk. Of course, you can work with the unions to make some changes here, but going here to both the sponsors to serve, know what it was like to bring this board to the floor in both chambers. I know Republicans were very upset that this new language was included. What were your thoughts?
Well, we work together. I just want to say my own comment is that we work together with legislators on this too. There obviously were, you know, teachers very interested in what the outcome of this would be. But most importantly, this is about public health, from my perspective, making sure that we're doing the right thing for the teachers, for the schools, for the communities that those teachers represent and work in. And of course, those teachers, like I said, are parents themselves. They are, you know, they had very, very tough times during these last 2 years, as many people did, but teachers especially, managing through these, you know, difficult ups and downs of the pandemic. So I think they deserve this kind of respect. I'm going to hand it over first to the Senate President and then to Janet.
Representative, you want to go first?
I'm happy to. You know, I was happy to work on this bill and to continue working on it with the governor. If you had listened to the debate on the first bill, what you would have seen is that a lot of my Republican colleagues, they asked me, very sincerely, I believe, to work with those the stakeholders. They wanted me to address the stakeholders and their concerns with this bill. We have dozens of pages of letters from those stakeholders, and their concern over and over again was that this bill treated vaccinated in the same way that it treated unvaccinated. So, you know, on the advice of my Republican colleagues, I went ahead and addressed the concerns that they asked me to address. So what we're doing here, we are making sure that those who are making the right decisions are, you know, are being, getting the benefits of this bill. So I'm very proud of this legislation.
And I would just add, I think this is an excellent example of how the legislative process works. We always try to seek agreement. Sometimes we do it before we pass a bill the first time. Other times that happens later. I applaud the governor for bringing everyone to the table and reaching an agreement. Happy to ratify that agreement. And that's just, again, a good example of how the process works.
The previous version was bipartisan. This one was a partisan vote. There was a debate about whether this should have passed yesterday. Essentially say nursing homes can make up their own policies when it comes to visitors so that people can die with dignity, so to speak. Are you planning on it? If lines are on your desk, are you going to change that and possibly make it partisan?
I haven't read the bill. I know of the bill, but you know, I can say that all of us want to make sure that we're not only keeping the residents of our nursing homes safe, but also making sure that they're able to get visitation. But remember, the pandemic that we have been going through is potentially not the only pandemic that we'll ever see. And so we want to make sure that whatever laws are put in place are appropriate going forward to make sure we keep particularly our most vulnerable people safe. And I know that, I think you had a question and I...
In the last few months, we've seen at least 5 children die despite the Department of Children and Family Services being involved sometimes up until weeks before the death. So where is the discrepancy? Why are these children being...
Yeah, let me start with, you know, as you know, from the very beginning, I've been deeply concerned about fixing the problems at DCFS. When I came into office, this agency had been decimated, truly hundreds of employees short of where it should have been, and it needed to be even greater, the agency, than it was. And so we worked on that. We've added 1,000 employees during my time in office. We've reduced the caseload, although the total number of cases has increased, the caseload per employee has reduced. Having said that, there's much more work to be done. This is always a challenging agency. Every administration that has come into office has seen the challenges of DCFS. The difference is we've taken significant action with the legislature to not only fund new positions, but also make sure they're providing more beds. Remember, under Governor Rauner, 500 beds. These are residential beds that could have been used now, were done away with. And it takes a long time to get back up to where we were after decimating the number of residential beds. So we have a lot more to do, but there have been successes at DCFS. For example, the hotline at DCFS, when I came into office, only 50% of the calls that were coming into the hotline to report neglect and abuse were being answered right away. Today, 99% of those calls being answered. So that's a big change. That's just one of the things that we've worked with outside consultants, including the University of Chicago, Chapin Hall, including the Annie E. Casey Foundation, to improve about DCFS. Much more to do.
They appreciate extra support for police, but one of the biggest forms of support they really would like to see, some of their others are killed by repeat offenders. They want to see consequences, sometimes tougher consequences, for suspects or criminals who commit repeat offenses. Can you speak to that idea as you consider a package of different public safety ideas? What is your message to those police widows on that request to get tougher on repeat offenders?
The fact of police being gunned down is a tragedy, and it is one that all of us want to go after the perpetrators of, all of us. I know that people want to politicize this, but the truth is that Democrats and Republicans want to make sure that those people are held accountable. So when there are repeat offenders, obviously there are laws on the books that say that repeat offenders get higher sentences than those who are first-time offenders. That's a good thing. And we're working very hard to protect our police. That's probably the most important thing we can do, is to protect our police, to build up their ranks, to make sure that they're properly funded, to make sure that they get the on the highways that'll help us catch the perpetrators who are shooting on the highways. So there's much to do here, but we are making progress, and I think before the end of this session, over the next several days, you're going to see even more. Thank you.
Governor,